It is my privilege today to converse with Rabindranath Maharaj. Robin, may I call you Robin?
Yeah.
Thank you, Robin. Robin is the author of 8 books. He began with 2 collections of short stories. His first novel, Homer in Flight, was a finalist for the Chapters Books in Canada First Novel Award. A Perfect Pledge was a finalist for the Commonwealth Writers Prize and the Rogers Writers Trust Prize. The Amazing Absorbing Boy won the Trillium Book Award and the City of Toronto Book Award. And the Lagahoo's Apprentice was a Globe and Mail and Toronto Star Notable Book of the Year. I was thinking about what it is that Robin does, and I think I'm going to try to put it all in one sentence. And then I figure we don't have to do the interview. And we can all get home earlier. In very terse and subtly visual prose, Rabindranath Maharaj employs his experiences of departure and arrival to make the world seem new to each of us and engage the reader in a sustained and willing sense of belief, a reader's world in which each possibility seems new, and sometimes the new possibilities seem old, and the old possibilities seem new. And it's a world in transformation. And I think with his Trinidadian emigrant experience that he is really at the forefront of a new wave of 21st century Canadian authors, authors who are really speaking to a Canada that is not the isolated dominion of old, but is reflective of the world stage. And I'm hoping that's somehow correct. Is that basically okay?
I believe so, yeah.
Robin, thank you for coming.
Thank you very much.
Let's go way back to the beginning. You were born in vaguely 55 mm-hmm. or something like that?
Yeah.
Okay, you grew up in Trinidad.
Yes.
Tell me about your family. First of all, your parents. What did your parents do?
Okay, before I do that, I have to thank John and the Writers Co-operative for inviting me. Yeah, I recall some of your faces from a workshop I had done before. I grew up in a small village in Trinidad. Trinidad was a colony that at one time had been administered by the British, the French, the Spanish, the Dutch. Almost every European power had a little stake in Trinidad. And what it did, I believe, is it created a kind of, I realize this in retrospect, it created a kind of a sort of multicultural sort of, not too dissimilar from Canada, so that in Trinidad, you in one village, you would have 3 or 4 different nationalities sort of coexisting. And it wasn't an idyllic place, but you know, after a period of time, people sort of grew to understand each other and they sort of got along. And there was a lot of mixture, so that in Trinidad, what you would find is there's a certain kind of hybridity. In terms of the dialect, the language, in terms of the people, in terms of the culture and everything like that. So I didn't realize this until a couple of years after I came to Canada. But this kind of combination of so many cultures, it gave me a sort of head start when I came to Canada. And it also allowed me, as it did other Trinidadian writers, it allowed me to look for differences, very subtle differences. And this is one of the things that I believe that writers tend to do. We always look for anomalies, for things that don't make sense, for things that don't match, for something that's missing in the pattern. And if I could just sort of, something you mentioned, I just want to touch on that. You spoke about developing a way, like, you know, sort of, the way writers develop a sort of vision to represent what is new and what changes are taking place. One of the things that I always believe, and the older I am, I become, and the more experienced I have become too, I'm kind of become more assured of this, is that writers don't try to create worlds or societies that are really, really overly dramatic and so on. What we do is we try to take something that's familiar and show it in a new way. so that people who are familiar, who might be familiar with this place, whether it's Toronto, whether it's a family situation, breakfast, you know, a couple having breakfast, whether it's a divorce or a funeral, people would say, you know what, I never looked at it this way before. So this is what I believe writers do. We take something that's familiar, but we find some unique way of representing it. We can't write as well, most writers, as let's say Michael Ondaatje or Margaret Atwood and so on, but we don't have to. We're all born with our own perception, our own experiences.
I wanted to ask you about that. There's clearly at some level an autobiographical element to your work, but there's an alchemy, of course, of fact and fiction. Can you think of any characters you have who started out really as, you know, it was that guy and then sort of evolved into something else? Can you describe that sort of alchemy of fact and fiction that you go through?
What happens is it's an odd kind of situation, like my last book, for instance, just to use, you know, the most recent example, I decided I'd write a book in which the main character, the narrator, was a young immigrant. By the way, I should also tell you that I didn't, when I started that book, I had in mind a main character who was in his mid-30s, but then I felt that I didn't want to do that because that kind of book had been written before. And I felt that the immigrants to Canada, they're a bit different now. They're younger, more savvy. They tend to know more about their host country, about the country, you know, to which they're going to come, than the older sort of immigrant. So I realized I had to create a different kind of immigrant novel. But getting back to the question, very often it's only later on that I realize that my character is based on somebody or a kind of composite kind of person. I never start off with that in mind. I begin writing kind of very, very sporadically, and you know, for maybe for about a month or 2 months, I'm trying to get the correct voice, and eventually a character, I have a vague idea of the plot and a vague idea as to some of the characters, but that first month, it's a kind of experimentation to see where the plot is going to go to and what my main character, what kind of voice a novel is going to take, and the sort of personality of my main character. The main character, I realized in The Amazing Absorbing Boy, almost towards the end, was based to a large extent of the personality and the voice of that character on my brother. Now, my brother, he was a comic book reader, and he passed away when he was, I think, 27, he was going to 28 years. And I remember when I went back, I was 10 years older than him, when I went back for his cremation, he was just about to finish his PhD, and after his cremation, I was going through his notes, and I saw, together with all his notes, I saw some of the comic books that I used to read to him when he was a little kid. And it was very touching, and I knew I would do something with that fictionally, in a fictional sense. But I didn't realize what it was going to be. So towards the end of the book, I realized, wait a minute, this is, my brother's name is Darren. This main character is very much like him. With a perfect pledge, I had a fair idea, like the main character was based on two oldish people from Trinidad. And I didn't know how this was going to develop. So I have to tell you this, none of my characters that I've written about in any of the books, it's based on me or my own experiences. It would sound kind of odd. It's always, of course, it's kind of autobiographical because these characters sometimes have my perspective, you know, and sometimes a bit of my life and the flavor.
What is your writing process like? How many hours do you work a day? And just generally, what's it like for the experience of writing? Is it difficult?
Okay, I have to break down that question in two parts. I try to write twice for the day. In the mornings, I write about 3 hours, and it varies, which it's usually about 8 to 11 or 9 to 12 or even earlier than that. But I have to take a break because I find that once 3 hours pass, I begin to kind of lose focus. And then I write, I read, or I do, you know, I don't know, mostly read, or I think about what I'm writing. And then I begin to write about 5 or 6 in the afternoons and evenings and so on. So I write usually about 5 hours. Sometimes those 5 hours would produce about 6 or 7 typewritten pages. Sometimes it would produce 1 paragraph. So the trick is not trying to count how much I write, but how, you know, it's difficult to evaluate the success of the writing day by how much you've written.
My final question, we've been talking about your past, your present, and your future. And Franz Kafka once said about writers, he said a writer's greatest dream is to narrate his own funeral. W.C. Fields, one of the smartest men the Victorian England produced, had sort of a solution to that. He suggested that his epitaph should read, "All things considered, I'd rather be in Philadelphia." What would you like your epitaph to read?
That's an interesting question. I've never thought of this before. Maybe it's time I start thinking.
I think you've got a few years, but if you...
But you know what, the reason why, it's maybe it's an old kind of superstition where people in Trinidad, in the village I grew up, used to say, if you think about something too much, it actually happens very quickly.
That's
so
right.
Who knows? But, the question would be, he did all that he could, or something to that effect. We all gifted with certain abilities, but we all limited by certain things too, whether it's personality, whether it's mood, whether it's discipline or whatever. One of the most important things in writing, by the way, is discipline, equal to talent. So I'd be very happy if somebody wrote, he did all that he could.
I would like to confirm that in my opinion, during this interview, Rabindranath Maharaj did all we could, and so let's thank him for that. Are there any questions? Yes, ma'am.
I'm just wondering, when you start a novel, do you work out the outline very in details?
No, I don't. I know some writers, I'd say about half of the writers tend to do that, especially writers of commercial fiction, genre fiction, mystery and so on. I tend not to do it. I have a vague idea. I always start my novels with a main character. And during the first month or 2 months, I try to get to know this character better. And as I get to know him or her better, I begin to see what he or she could do. I begin to see how he or she might react in particular kinds of situations. And then the plot begins to develop. Like with my... which I believe is my best novel, A Perfect Pledge. I start off with this old man standing next to a cane field. A couple of days afterwards, I realized that the cane field was burning. 2 weeks afterwards, I saw an old windmill next to it. And then a family appeared. And I got to know this fellow better and better and better. And within 3 weeks or so, I knew him so well that I understood his voice. What he would say, and understanding his voice and novel's voice too came to me. So I always started with a main character, but I guess I started with a kind of theme, like this book is going to be, like the last book, Amazing Absorbent Boy, is going to be about a young immigrant and his father, and the comparison between the old and the new types of immigrants. But I have no idea what's going to happen. I never know how the book is going to end, and I feel if I know this, I'd stop writing. Like, it wouldn't be interesting to me. Like, I write to explore, to figure, to know things. And when I discover new things, I feel excited about
it. Thank you, Robin, again.